When you think about the notion of getting the message across, getting the message out, you talk many times about how you've had to take a complex subject, perhaps, like being number one and two in a business, and make it just that simple as number one or number two. Could you talk about how you have to boil down the message?
Well, I think anytime you want to move the needle, you have to be extreme. I mean, let's take quality. I think, you know, it's the best one of all. There must be 8 million quality slogans out there. Okay, 8 million.
I hate most of them.
But yeah, they're just terrible. So when we started our Six Sigma initiative, after having no faith in these programs for years, I decided to launch it after I had heard Larry Bossi at Allied Signal tell me how good it was, tell our team how good it was. I could have said, let's have a quality program. Quality is good for the customer. Quality is good for everyone. No. You had to say, we got to put our best on quality. We got to absolutely check them. We got to review them. We got to see who they are. We got to go out to the field and visit with the quality leaders. And then when the stock option time comes, we say, only the quality leaders get stock options this year.
That gets your attention.
And pretty soon you start getting phone calls. I don't have enough options. I don't have enough stock options. Well, I thought you put your best in quality. Well, we didn't put all the best in quality. They weren't all the best. They slipped a few Mickeys in there. And the facts are you can't have that. So you got to redress it and go back. You got to repeat yourself so many times. You can't drop these flavor of the months in, jump around. We've only had 4 or 5 initiatives in 20 years. And it takes enormous amount of time and effort and repetition and proof. You got to close loop the system so that the rewards match the behavior you want. In the end, people are basically good. You get what you measure and what you reward. So if you reward certain behavior, you'll get it. But like the best one of all is the sales contest at the end of the year. It's the favorite. We got to have so much in sales the fourth quarter to make the year. Okay, they put a contest in. Next thing that happens is they get the sales. CEO looks, no profits. Where are the profits? Well, you didn't tell me about margin, you just told me about sales. I mean, it's the simplest, it doesn't happen that often, but it has happened in my experience, in our company, where you get behavior, you reward.
You have to be very careful what you're paying for because you'll get exactly that behavior.
You got to keep looking, as you know from your experience in business, you got to keep going back and re-looking at all your reward systems. Do they match what you're looking for?
Why is that so hard? I find that over and over again that the compensation and reward systems are kind of mismatched.
Well, they get outdated. Things change, priorities change, and people don't change the system.
If you take a closer look then at this issue of having to get out there and repeat the message, here's another paradox. How do you manage the fact that if you're out there shouting, trying to get the message out, how do you create a way to make sure that you're listening long enough to get the great ideas?
Oh, because in our case, we have an educational center where we all spent 5 and 6 hours a class teaching and listening, and the feedback there is right between the eyes. And so all the manager, all the leadership is there getting that feedback. I mean, we also do something else. We run an annual survey, 15,000 people anonymously. It's remarkable what you get out of that. I mean, I hate to sound like a CEO that manages by polling, but our quality initiative came out of that. Absolutely a need for better quality from our employees, screaming.
They said make it better so that I can
make it better. We got to focus more on quality. And so, I mean, I can give you several things that we've done. The measurement system, where they say, you know, another thing that where they say we're not doing it enough, we're not rewarding the right behavior. Another thing that would shock you, the worst question we get, the worst response, the most negative G response is from the lower level, we measure 3 tiers of managers. GE, the question is, GE is not tough enough on weak performers. Okay?
Really?
And the top says, well, we are. Well, the bottom says, we're not. Why? Because they know Say you're in a rowboat with 12 people rowing, six on each side. Now, most of us don't row the boat. Most of us just talk about the ideas or the orders. If you're on the rowboat and one or two on one side aren't rowing, you're going around in a circle. So the people that are closest to the work know who's doing it and who isn't. And they're angry at their boss when they're working their tails off that the others aren't. And their boss isn't recognizing it. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it's amazing. That question is every single year, despite our talking about it and talking about it, our people don't feel we're tough enough on poor managers.
Although you gave me a peek of those numbers earlier in the year as they were coming out, and I think most CEOs would be pretty envious of the change.
Oh, yeah. The numbers are great, but we still have a ways to go, okay? I mean, 30 to 40% of the people don't think we're tough enough at the lower levels on our managers.
That's interesting. Now, if you take this one step further then, so we're listening, we're evaluating. Once there's an idea that comes flowing through the system, either internally or externally. I was very impressed with this notion of you bringing in, I think, a bunch of Army colonels and asking them, and here you've been married to this idea of being number one or number two. You've been pounding it away on the management team. And here you tell a story on yourself, if you could.
Well, it's a classic. We had a class that was, that we have at Groveville that goes out for this action learning every year. And we had a number of these. And this group was to study growth. And they went to the Intels of the world and all the growth companies to get best ideas on growth and come back and report to us. One of the guys in the class had the idea of going to the U.S. Army War College. It wasn't my idea. I don't know how they came up with that idea. They went to the U.S. Army War College, and a colonel there in the class said, look at you guys, this number one and number two strategy is limiting you. The system can get gamed. In other words, the market can be defined so narrowly that you're always number one. Let's take chairs like this with arms that curve down. Okay, we're number one in this market. Not furniture, number one in this market as an extreme. Well, this class came back and punched me right between the nose, which took great strength after 14 years of preaching this. Came back and said, we think you ought to define markets in such a way that no one can have more than a 10% market share. Okay, now when we did that, I love the idea. I thought it was the freshest idea I'd heard in years. Within a month at our operating plan reviews, we had every business come in with redefined markets. And we started to grow. We started to grow in peripheral markets like crazy. Our top line exploded. I mean, it's a simple idea. The principle is you can never define your market share as more than 10% of any one market. That makes your mind just expand. You got to find 90% stuff that's relevant that you can go in.